सेक्रेटरीज सुनील गाबावाला एंड सुहास परांजपे, ट्रेजरर मनीष संपत, पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट्स ऑफ द सोसाइटी, प्रोफेशनल्स, टैक्स पेयर्स एंड माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीवन एंड वेलकम टू दिस पब्लिक मीटिंग ऑन डायरेक्ट टैक्स प्रोविजंस ऑफ द फाइनेंस बिल 2017. दिस इज द 52nd बजट लेक्चर मीटिंग बाय द BCAS ऑन द टॉपिक एंड इज वेबकास्ट लाइव. I wish to extend a warm welcome to the distant viewers who could not be at this venue but are effectively connected through technology. Friends, a budget means many things. A budget is a yearly routine, a session of the parliament, a document, a piece of legislation, and a financial estimate of the government. Yet this time, it does have a few special features. The FM has cracked the convention of presenting the budget on the last day of the February to advancing it by 27 days to the 1st of February. That day also happened to be a Vasant Panchami, a seasonal transition to spring, celebrated all across the country by a number of sections of the society. The budget also appeared to be a truly union budget, one budget for the entire union. As after decades, someone thought of merging the railway budget with the mainstream budget. This in fact would act as a booster for the allocation of funds for the railway infrastructure, since the shackles of allocation of funds from only railway revenues are broken. While the role of the FM seems exciting and preceded by the halwa making ceremony, not the hawala, and the speech is often adorned with poetry, humor and sarcasm, managing finances in India is not only an arduous task but also calls for tremendous responsibility to steer our nation in the desired direction. The budget gives the disha that will determine the dasha of the country in the year ahead. In 2016, we celebrated 25 years of liberalization and opening up of Indian economy. We have come a long way. From licensing to abolishing of FIPB, from government being in business of controlling everything to disinvestment targets of ₹72,500 crores, from bankruptcy in 1991 to $350+ billion in reserves, from standing in queues for hours to get a train ticket to number of travelers traveling on air crossing the total number of travelers traveling in first and second class of AC. Today, we live in the most stimulating time, a tipping point in the history of not only our nation, but our civilization, as we are in the midst of a huge leap forging through digitization. India would perhaps be the largest beneficiary of the digital revolution that will see miraculous number of hacks that will eliminate all that is pulling us down. It seems that the new trinity of JAM, that is the Jan Dhan account, the Aadhaar and the mobile could be the new Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh to redeem those who are in the severe need. While most people rate, rank and rant about so many aspects of the union budget, some without reading the fine print, others within minutes of the speech being delivered. However, the professions, especially in Mumbai, have been passionately pursuing the devil in the details year after year through this lecture. The tax proposals do remain an area of focus for many of us, and while some start talking about it within hours of the budget speech, the professionals start reading through the finance bill. The talk of the FM certainly has many figures, but it also has many figures of speech. A figure of speech is meant to be figurative, but at the cost of clarity. And that is why I said the devil is in the details. Friends, what the FM speech does not state, we have CSE Dastoor to unravel it for us at this lecture meeting. For those who are new, Sri Dastoor is a senior advocate. He is a person of extraordinary acumen and generosity personified, a role model for young and experienced. To use the current Bollywood jargon, he is Rais in knowledge of tax laws and Kabil in his capability to analyze the subject. Siddhartha is also eloquence personified. I would like to share a quote by a French mathematician which aptly summarizes what Mr. Dastur is. Eloquence is the art of saying things in such a way that those to whom we speak may listen to them with pleasure. Today, Dastur Sahib is delivering his 29th lecture on the Union Budget for the BCS. Before I call Mr. Dastur to share his views on the budget, as a mark of our appreciation and regard, I request our Vice President, Mr. Narayan, to present a memento on all our behalf.
Sir.
Once again, please join me in welcoming Mr. Dastur.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, taking a cue from what you have presented to me, may I wish all of you smooth sailing in life always. Mr. Chairman has referred to some firsts, that this is the first time that the budget is presented on the first instead of the last day of February. May I share some other historical memories with you? The first budget of modern India, that is of India when it was born, was presented in 48-49 by Sir Shanmukhan Chetty. And that was presented on 28th February 1948 at 5 p.m. Why 5 p.m.? Because people in England wanted to view the presentation of budget in their colony. And 5 p.m. was a good time for them to view it around 11:30 a.m. If it was at 11 a.m., they would have had to be up by 5 a.m. in the morning. Times have changed, and now the budget was presented for the first time at 11 a.m. in 1999-2000. And that was by Mr. Yashwant Sinha. When he was interviewed and asked why he changed the time, he said that everybody chases me after the budget is presented, and that means that I have to be up till midnight. And therefore I thought it would be better to have it at 11 a.m. Incidentally, the first Indian budget was presented on 7th April 1860. By Mr. John Wilson. At that time, the financial year was May to April. It became April to March in 1867. Till 1964, the economic survey was a part of the budget documents. From 1964, the economic survey was prior to the presentation of the budget. The railway budget is a part of the union budget right from 1924. And this was on the recommendation of Sir William Ackworth. This year the two have merged. And that is another change brought about in this year. And the change in the date, I think, was particularly, the old date was particularly close to the heart of Mr. Morarji Desai, because his birthday was on 29th February. Fittingly, he has presented 8 full and 2 interim budgets. The finance minister has said that the advantage of preponing the date is that we avoid a vote on account. Otherwise, there has to be a vote on account, then after the budget is presented. This is the first budget after the 5-year plan era. And therefore, the classification between plan and not plan outlay has been done away with. As I look around, I find several people with a frown on their face. They seem to think that there is nothing much to be said in the budget and therefore the historical retrospect. There are others who far outnumber them who have a sense of relief on their face that they won't have to wait long till this speech is over. But I'm afraid there are several items in this budget which I'd like to refer to. There is today the main thing which the finance minister and our prime minister keep on emphasizing is they want to get rid of the cash economy. And the first several amendments have been made with this in mind. First of all, political parties are prohibited from accepting cash donations in excess of 2,000 rupees. As per section 13A, contributions in excess of that amount have to be in bank form or in the form of electoral bonds. Electoral bonds are bearer bonds which one purchases, hands it over to the political party who will encash it on the expiry of the term. The finance minister's speech and in the memorandum explaining the provisions, it is emphasized that this will maintain secrecy of the donors. At the same time, the finance minister waxes eloquent on transparency. If you want to maintain secrecy of something, then you don't emphasize transparency. Now, which is the via media is something you have to judge. Can you have full disclosure, or would political parties always want anonymous donations? The next item on this cash list is section 35AD. It allows deduction for capital expenditure for specified business. Now, no deduction will be available if such expenditure to a person in one day exceeds 10,000. So you can have it to several persons on the same day. You can have it to one person on several days. But to the same person on the same day, if it is a cash payment, it will not be allowed as a deduction. Section 48(3) of the Act provides that if you pay to a person more than rupees 20,000 in cash, then that will not be allowed as a deduction. Now that limit is reduced to 10,000. You can pay up to 10,000 if you want to get a deduction, otherwise you won't get a deduction. Then 44AD provides for presumptive taxation for small businesses. And the presumptive profit is fixed at 8% of the turnover. It is now provided that whatever is the amount received by check which goes into the turnover, the percentage will be 6 and not 8. Now, whether you can have the rate percentage of what is estimated profit depending on whether you get a check payment or a cash payment, doesn't make much sense to me. But that is provided so as to encourage people to collect the money in check. Secondly, such a concession, however, is not provided to professional people who opt for presumptive taxation. Also, it is not provided to people who own carriages, who are assessed at a presumptive rate of 7,500 per carriage, but only in respect of presumptive taxation for small businessmen. Depreciation, as you know, is available on the actual cost of an asset. If cash is paid for acquiring the capital asset, depreciation will not be available in respect of that portion of the cash. Also, if a donation is made to a charitable institution, today the limit is 10,000. Now, if anything beyond 2,000, it will not be permitted as a deduction under Section 80G. Then Clause 83, which has been referred to so often, inserts in a new section 269SDST, which prohibits acceptance by a person of 3 lakhs of rupees or more on one day in cash from one person. Now here again, 3 lakhs from one person on one day, you can have it on several days, you can have it from more than one person, but that is the position. Or in respect of a single transaction, irrespective of the payment being made over several days. So if one purchases an asset, you cannot pay for that over a period of days, if in cash, but otherwise it will be in breach of this provision. Or from one person in respect of a transaction relating to one event or one occasion. In all these, you have to make payment in the bank form. If any one of the conditions in Section 269ST is violated, there is a penalty under Section 271DA, and that is 100% of the amount paid. The next provision I'd like to refer to is Clause 7 of the Finance Bill with regard to Section 10AA. Controversy had arisen, because this is a deduction provision, that is the profit made by a unit which fulfills the conditions of Section 10AA, can one get a deduction for that entire profit? If so, it would be almost treating it like an exemption provision. In fact, the Supreme Court in CIT versus Yokogawa accepted that yes, you will get it as if it is an exemption provision. Now it is stated that you first compute your total income before giving the deduction under 10AA. And if there is a positive figure, you will get the 10AA deduction from that. So that if the total income pre-10AA is less than the 10AA deduction you are entitled to, you will not get the full 10AA deduction. Next item which I would refer to is, in regard to this cash payments, is to charitable trusts. It is mandatory to apply 85% of the income of a trust for charitable purposes to get exemption under Section 11. Now it is provided that if a charitable trust makes a contribution to another charitable trust and says it is for the purposes of the corpus, that will not be regarded as application. So that you're in determining your 85%, whether that limit has been reached, that donation will not be taken into account. The purpose obviously is because people used to give corpus contribution, the charity receiving the corpus contribution would in its own turn give a corpus contribution to another charity, and thereby application for the purposes of charity would get delayed. Now, one can understand the reason for this, but to say that it will not be regarded as application, to me, does not seem to be appropriate. Perhaps, in my view, it may be better to provide that the recipient of a corpus contribution must spend it within 5 years. Because you may want to make a corpus contribution. Somebody is constructing a hospital. You want to make a corpus contribution. You are prohibited now because otherwise the 85% limit will not be here. But you can impose a condition on the recipient that that recipient must apply the amount within a period of 5 years. To me, that seems to be a more appropriate thing to do. There are charitable trusts, and obviously the objects of the charity are registered. If the trust applies its income otherwise than for the registered purpose, the commissioner can cancel the registration under section 12AA3. It is now provided that if a charitable trust changes its objects or wants to apply the income for what was not originally an object of the trust, then you must make a fresh application to the commissioner for registration, who will then consider whether the changed object also meets the test of charity. So therefore, a fresh obligation is now imposed again to apply for registration. If the benefit of exemption under 11 and 12 is not available unless the trust files its income within the time provided in 139(4)(a). And if it doesn't file it, it will not get exemption. I would presume that will only apply for that year. So that in 1 year, if you file delayed, you may not get exemption, but you will get it in the subsequent years. Again, I would think there should be a provision for the trust to show that there was reasonable cause for not having filed it in time, instead of denying the exemption completely, straight away. Such a provision, I think, would be reasonable, and perhaps our finance minister may accept it, because that exception will also help political parties, because they are under the same obligation. If they file the return late, they will not get exemption. So it may appeal to the finance minister as a politician, if not as a practitioner of law. The next set of provisions I'd like to refer to are with regard to capital gains. Clause 5A has been inserted, subsection 5A has been inserted in section 45. This deals with a case where a person who is the owner of land or building enters into an agreement to sell the same to a developer, and the developer in his turn agrees to give to the owner a part of the constructed area. He may give 5,000 square feet, he may give 1,000 square feet, whatever be the arrangement. The Bombay High Court in the case of Chaturbhuj Dwarkadas took the view that this will be assessed as a capital gain in the year in which the land is handed over to the builder. This would mean that unless the builder paid sufficient advance money, one would have to pay capital gains tax without having the funds to pay it. In life, there is always the flip side. The advantage of this was that it was valued, the full value of the consideration was valued as on the date on which the land was handed over. Obviously, that would be much lesser than if you were to value it after the construction. Because at the date when it is handed over, one doesn't know how long it will take to construct, whether the builder will construct, and what will happen. Now it is provided that the time for charging capital gains will be the year in which the completion certificate is received. Flip side again, the value at that time will be much more than at the moment. So therefore you gain in the point of time, you lose in the quantum of the gain on which tax will have to be paid. Therefore, capital gain payable later, but on much more than what would have been if you were to pay capital gains tax in the year in which you hand over the land. Now there is a possibility that the landowner, obviously the person who has given the land, he will get the constructed area. He will sell, when you take the fair market value on the date of handing over of the property, it will be what is the stamp duty value. Now, the person who receives this property from the builder may in his turn sell it at some point of time. At that time, the cost of acquisition in his hand will be what was taken as the full market value, the full value of the consideration for the purpose of paying capital gains tax. If the builder is to pay you, the owner of the land, some monetary amount also, then he has to deduct tax at source at 10% of that amount. If he is not to pay a monetary amount, there is no obligation to deduct tax at source. Now here there is, as usual, a slight mix-up, I think. In the bill it is stated that if in addition to the area cash is paid. Now what do you mean by cash is paid? Does it mean if a check is paid then that is not to be taken into account? But in the memorandum explaining the provisions of the finance bill, the correct terminology is used if there is a monetary payment. So in the bill the reference to cash seems to be inappropriate because it will start a litigation on if it is by check, what is to happen. Then there is a possibility also that the person who owns the land and has given it to the builder may sell his right to get the constructed property before he actually gets it. So he enters into an agreement in say 2017, he is entitled to get 1/10 of the constructed area, he hasn't yet got it. In 2021 he may sell it to someone else, his right to get the property. In that case, in that year of sale, the capital gain tax which he would have paid in the year, if the transaction had gone through with the builder, he would have paid it when he received the certificate of completion. But if he transfers his share, in that year he will pay capital gains tax on the, in respect of the amount which he was, would have been liable for the transaction with giving the builder. In that case again, you will have to determine what is the fair value of the consideration as per the stamp duty because you will be handing over a percentage of your share in the immobile property which will require registration. So whatever is the stamp duty value will be taken as the full value of the consideration. Further, the fair market value should be in respect of capital gains, up till now, you could take the fair market value on 1481 and index it. The finance minister says that this meant that a person did not really get what would be the cost, which would mean only that the indexation you provide for is not adequate. Because if the indexation was adequate, you should have received what is the cost in that particular year. But in any case, now that date has been transferred to 1/4/2001. So if whatever is the value on 1/4/2001, that will be regarded as the date on which the cost of acquisition will be determined, plus, or of course you can have a higher cost if you have paid more, and indexed appropriately. Now here again, a bit of historical review. The date was 1st January 1954, under the Indian Income Tax Act, and also when the 61 Act came into force. This was changed to 1st January 1964, and this was by the Finance Act of 1977. Just as now the Finance Bill of 2017 makes it as of 1/4/2001, the Finance Act of 77 shifted the date from 54 to 64. Again, by the Finance Act of 86, the date was shifted from 1st January 64 to 1st April 74. By the Finance Act of 1992, the date was fixed to 1st April 1981, which is the present position. And now, by the Finance Act, it is shifted to 1st April 2001, from 1981. Now, another provision with regard to capital gains, which I think one should take in mind, is 50CA has now been inserted by clause 26 of the Finance Bill. It provides that if one transfers a non-quoted share, then the department, the revenue, can substitute the fair market value of the share as on the date of transfer, instead of the actual transfer price reflected, if that price is lesser. Now, why they've picked up only non-quoted shares and nothing else, I don't know, but something must have developed that people felt that non-quoted shares were being sold at much below the market price, and therefore this provision has been introduced. This is of the same type as the present position in 50C with regard to transfer of land and building below the stamp duty valuation, in which case he can take the stamp duty valuation for the purposes of assessing capital gain. When the purchaser of the share transfers the share, his cost of acquisition will be the amount regarded as the full value of the consideration on which tax has been paid by the transferor. Now here an interesting point arises. If A transfers shares or immovable property for a consideration of 100 and the department says it should be 120, he will pay tax, capital gains, on the footing of the sale value being 120. At the same time, the recipient would have got property worth 120 for 100. And department will invoke in his hand section 56(2)(7) as existing now and 56(2)(10) as now proposed. So in the same year, in respect of the 20 rupees, capital gains tax will be paid by the transferor and regular income tax by the transferee. The 20 rupees will get assessed twice in the same year. Of course, when the purchaser sells the property, he will get the cost of 120. But that may be 15 years later. And the value of 20 rupees 15 years later compared to today may be only 5 rupees. So there is an element of double taxation in the hands of the transferor as well as in the hands of the transferee, which is a point to be borne in mind. Whether this is completely just is a matter for consideration. The next issue on capital gains is, what is the period of holding to make an asset a long-term asset? If we are concerned with listed securities, it is 12 months. If we are concerned with unlisted securities, then The position is intriguing and to some extent gives you a flavor of how things can change. Unlisted securities, for the finance assessment year 15-16, the holding was 12 months. 16-17, it became 36 months, increased by 24. 17-18, it becomes 24 months. So it has varied from 12 to 36. 12, 36, 24. If it is immovable property, the period has been 36, except that in the present budget, the period is reduced to 24 months. If it is any other capital asset, uniformly 36 months. So the period will vary from 12 months to 36 months. Then, the time limit for completion of assessments. The finance minister says assessments must be made early, and therefore he proposes to reduce the time limit for making assessments to 12 months. It was initially 24 months in 2006, it was reduced to 21 months, then 18 months, and now it is within 12 months he has to make the assessment. Now, people will say, that's very good, we will get the assessment early. But I'm not an optimist, and I would think the flip side is that in the hurry of making the assessment for 12 months, he will make additions which are wholly unjustifiable and inequitable. I would think the present position is okay, but anyway, now within 12 months he has to make the adjustment. Then we come to a very interesting provision. That is what is referred to a new insertion of 92 CE and what is termed as a secondary adjustment. Now, transfer pricing is applied and a primary adjustment is made. You have sold an asset to an associated enterprise for 100. The department says, no, it should have been sold for 150. And this is with regard to a sale to a foreign associated enterprise. And therefore, I will determine your profit on the footing that the consideration is 150 and not 100. This is the primary adjustment he will make. This was the position up till now. Now, somebody in the finance ministry had the brilliant idea that if India has paid 150 to that person, then you should get back that paid only 100, then you get back that 50. So secondary adjustment will be made. And the Indian concern will have to get that 50 from the foreign enterprise. Now, how will you get it? I don't know. Obviously, that party, if he is to pay 50, will have his own tax complications in his country. But this is the position. If you don't get back that 50, it will be regarded that 100 is the amount you have paid and 50 is an advance which you have made to that person, a sort of loan. On that 50, which you don't get, you will be charged interest every year at the prescribed rate. So if the prescribed rate is 10, in the first rate year you will be charged 5 as interest. In the second year, whether you will be charged on 55 or 5, I don't know. Whether it will be compounded, not compounded, but there it is. So you are to pay also interest. Now please consider this. If this is regarded as an advance, then it may also be taken as a dividend under 222E. Because you've given a loan or an advance, and that attracts the provision of 222E if there is a percentage of shareholding as prescribed therein. So first of all, that 50 you will not get as a deduction. 50 is treated as an advance, that may be regarded as a dividend. And if you have not deducted tax at source, I don't know what will be the complication. And again, every year that amount will go up with interest. Now, one simple question which the finance ministry can answer is that if a foreign country also provides for secondary adjustment, will India permit the Indian party to make the payment? Foreign party has sold to India and has sold at a lesser value. So the foreign party tells the Indian concern, now please pay up that 50. Will Indian law accept it? If it does, what will it be? You will get a deduction for it. So I would think, if you are not prepared to get into the shoes of the foreign government which makes that guy, you have no business to provide this condition when the Indian party sells to the associated enterprise. Now please bear one more thing in mind. Associated enterprise definition in the Act is not dependent on shareholding connection. It varies even with regard to, depends on the financial transactions you have. It may be with a person with whom you are not connected, will still be regarded as an associated enterprise. So you may have no control, no right of management, but still this draconian provision will apply. Because associated enterprise is to have the meaning given in 92A subsection 2. Now, whilst we are on this, I would like to draw your attention to what is regarded as an associated enterprise. You will appreciate that most double taxation avoidance agreements in Article 10 tell you what is an associated enterprise. It says, an enterprise of a contracting state participating directly or indirectly in the management, control or capital of another enterprise will be an associated enterprise. And if the same persons participate directly or indirectly in the management or control. But Section 92A takes it far beyond that. There may be no management, no participation, no control, but still regarded as an associated enterprise. Question is, what is the consequence? The Supreme Court tells us that if there is a conflict between a treaty and an act, then the more beneficial treaty provision will prevail. So this may mean that all enterprises which are regarded as associated enterprises under the Act will not be associated enterprises. This will mean that all transfer pricing primary adjustments which are being made may also be at fault because they are not associated enterprises. I do not know why this issue has not been agitated. That under the treaty, associated enterprise means much less. Again, under the treaty, Article 10.2 says how you will determine the profits. And it says it will be determined the profit, what would have been the price if the conditions had been similar. No question of apply this method or that method or method which gives you more result or less result. You have just to make whatever is appropriate economically. So also, the procedure of determining the transfer price seems to me wholly inapplicable where there is a treaty connection. This will of course cut at the root of transfer pricing. And at least what little I have seen and what little I understand about transfer pricing, the additions in transfer pricing are far more than you ever made under the Act. It is provided that this adjustment will be made only if it is in excess of 1 crore. But I don't know in how many cases a transfer pricing adjustment of 1 crore or less has been made. One always sees amounts which are unbelievable, which are added at transfer pricing. So therefore, this issue and this associated enterprise is a far larger issue than merely secondary adjustment or primary adjustment, because it would have a reflection on whatever can be done in transfer pricing. But as I say, except in one case, I don't think this issue has been taken up anywhere, and let us see what happens. Then one more thing. In double taxation avoidance agreement, there is always a non-discrimination clause, that you will not discriminate against the foreign enterprise in a manner different from what you would do with a local enterprise. Article 10 of the Model Treaty says, nationals of a contracting state shall not be subject to any taxation or requirement which is other or more onerous and connected requirements to which nationals of the other state are subject. Now this primary adjustment and secondary adjustment is only with regard to foreign enterprises. There is no provision for making, thank God, no provision for making such an adjustment in a transaction with an Indian enterprise. Then this is clearly contrary in discrimination. So how can you have such a provision? The double taxation avoidance agreement specifically says you cannot have such an agreement. What I find, surprising, is that it is stated that this is the normal OECD practice to have these secondary adjustments. Now, I don't know about OECD, I don't know about OECD practice, but to me it means most strange that you can have this, and in defiance of DTA provisions. Of course, other countries don't regard DTAs with that much sanctity as we regard. Other countries may take the view that no, the Act will override the DTA. But insofar as India is concerned, that is not the position. So though it may be based on OECD best practices, as they call it, I don't see any sense in it. And there are several other OECD practices which we do not follow. So is it that a practice followed by a foreign country, which gives me more taxes, will be adopted, but not the other way around? Surely, what is sauce for the goose should be the sauce for the gander also. Then, coming back to secondary adjustment, it also provides that you will alter your accounts. The Indian party will alter accounts to show that the sale, that the price paid is only 100 and not 150. How will you do it? 150 is the sale price. You are supposed to alter your accounts to do this and to show a loan. Now, the Companies Act 2013 provides for provisions under in which you can alter your accounts. One of them is not that you will alter your accounts to take into account what the finance ministry says. It has to be that there is something wrong in what you have stated, or something inequitable in what you have stated. You cannot just alter accounts. So perhaps we should have the same minister looking after company law as the Income Tax Act, so that the Income Tax Law Minister, who is a very distinguished lawyer, does not forget what the Companies Act says. So it is impossible to carry this out. Then, as I say, the reopening of accounts is dealt with in Section 130 of the Companies Act 2013, and it doesn't permit this sort of an adjustment at all. We then come to certain Yes. We come to certain other provisions which are there, which I would like to just rush through quickly. Now, there is provision in the Act in section 80IBA to encourage construction for the poorer section by providing that you must construct giving a certain area to the person and you must construct within 3 years. Now, to construct something within 3 years is a near impossibility, and therefore the period has now been extended to 5 years. Previously, it was also provided, and I think this was very, very thoughtful, that the minimum area should be so many square feet built up area, depending on where the construction is to take place. Within the major cities, within a certain distance from the cities, whether in the rural areas. It is now stated that instead of the built up area, you must provide that area as a constructed area. I understand there is probably a difference of 20% between built up area and constructed area. So this means that the person to whom you sell will get a larger area, which I think is very, very good. Because if you induce in a person the sense that yes, I've got this area which is very good, it enthuses the younger generation to go forward. And therefore there are certain communities which actually provide for housing in good areas. So this is a good provision. Then it is also provided that land and building will be regarded as a long-term asset if it is for more than 24 months, which we have already referred to. Then clause 12 deals with section 23(5). It says that if land is held or if building is held as stock in trade, its annual letting value will be zero for the year in which the construction certificate is received and for 1 year more. So therefore, if a person who is a dealer in land holds immovable property, he will not have to pay tax on the deemed annual letting value. He will get this period of, which could be either 13 months or 24 months, within which the annual letting value will be taken as only zero. Then there is a provision, a new section 79. 79, as you know, provides for setting off of past losses against current income. And it says that, as it exists today, if there is a change in shareholding to the extent of 51% in the year of set-off compared to the shareholding in the year in which the loss was incurred, then you will not be able to set off the loss. That provision is retained. But a new clause B is now added. And clause B says that a loss incurred by a closely held startup company, because a startup company is also defined, for 7 years from the year of incorporation can be set off even if the 51% condition is not fulfilled. But, persons who are shareholders when the company was incorporated must continue to be shareholders in the year in which the loss is to be set off. And it has to be a startup. Now, things which have not been thought of. Number one, the person who must continue to be a shareholder, must he also continue to hold the same number of shares as before? If ABCD were shareholders in year one, in the year in which it is to be set off, and they had equal shares, can it be that A now holds 97% and BCD only hold 1% each? There is a dispute as to not only must there be the same shareholders, But must they continue to hold the same number of shares? I dare say I hear a big sigh of relief, because that will encourage litigation. Then, another thing, that should really this be, not be an independent provision, but 79B should be a proviso to A, that even if there is a 51% change, if these conditions are fulfilled, you will get the benefit of the loss set off. Now, one more thing. The loss set off is permitted in respect of a loss incurred for 7 years. And you may say, 7 years loss is allowed. But 7 years from the date of incorporation of the company. So if a company is incorporated in year one, it will set up business only in year four. So that 7 years is of no use. No company in the first year of incorporation makes a loss. And the Bombay High Court has taken the view that you must first of all be set up before there can be any question of loss being allowed. So this 7 years from the date of incorporation seems to be wholly unjustified, and only seems to tell the people, we are giving you 7 years losses. But I can't get more than 3 years losses actually, because setting up will take some time. So this 7 years is permitted, you can carry it forward and you can set it off. Now one more thing. 79B applies to an eligible startup. That is, a new enterprise, eligible startup. Now, that has been defined to mean that your turnover should not be more than 25 crores. Now, supposing you incur a loss in year two or three or whatever it is, you set it off because turnover is not more than 25 crores. But your turnover goes up, because the turnover limit is for the full period. Your turnover goes up in year five. So you are no longer an eligible startup. Now what? What was allowed in year two will be withdrawn, because you no longer qualify as a startup. So again here, it seems a lack of, not imagination, but a lack of just seeing what is in front of you. That when you provide for a 7 year period, and that is not met with because of this condition, what will happen to the loss which is already set off? Will you reopen that? Again, this is a matter where again there will be great scope for litigation. I referred some time ago to 56.27(7A) regarding if a person receives money or receives property for a consideration less than 50,000 rupees, that will be assessed to tax in the hands of the recipient. Now 56.27 and 7A are done away with. Please don't heave a sigh of relief, because that has been substituted by clause 10. So the provision only shifts in number. One thing interesting is this. The definition of income in section 224 includes in it the amount for which the recipient will be taxable. That is not income. If I get, let us say, a gift of 55,000, it is more than 50,000, I will be assessed to income tax. But 55 is certainly not income. Now, therefore, this was included in income in the artificial definition of income in section 224. But they have not included clause 10 in definition of income. So as of today, though there is clause 10, it is not income. And therefore, if they don't change it, then it will mean that 56.27 is gone, and 56.210 cannot be invoked because they have not regarded it as income. So this is one more thing which, if the revenue or if the finance ministry wants really to implement it, this is what they have to do. Now, previously, the exemption was in respect of people who receive something without consideration for consideration less than 50,000, that charitable trusts were regarded as exempt. Now they have included other institutions also who will not be chargeable to tax if they receive this. Receipt on partition, for example, because you don't pay anything. Or transfer by an amalgamating company to the amalgamated company. Amalgamating company receives nothing. All these are also included now, and 56.27 or 210, as the case may be, will not apply. I'm sure the revenue will now take the place that all amalgamations prior to the insertion of this provision come within 56.27, because now they are exempt. Earlier they were not exempt. Obviously that is not so, because it could not have been applied and therefore it was not necessary to provide for the exemption, but I am sure this stand will be taken and one will have to meet it. The Supreme Court has held in the case of Commissioner of Income Tax versus Madurai Mills that merely because an exemption is provided in year 5 does not mean that in years 1 to 4 it was taxable, if it was not really taxable, because in year 5, out of abundant caution, you have put it in. So now one thing which really arises is this: charitable trusts are exempt. But supposing you make a private trust, of course, in tax matters, the trust has been completely misused. The very function of a trust was to provide for your family members, for your relatives, for your friends. It is used now for tax purposes, but forget that for a moment. Now, you create a trust. You put 1 crore of rupees on trust. You hand it over to the trustee. Will 56.27 apply or not apply? Because he gets something without consideration. Charitable trusts are exempt. Department men say, yes, charitable trusts are exempt, private trusts are not. In my opinion, it was not necessary to provide for an exemption for charitable trusts, because what is a trust? A trust is an obligation accepted by the trustee at the request of the settlor. So when you accept an obligation, it is not without consideration. The acceptance of the obligation is consideration. Therefore, 56.27 should not apply to private trusts also. But up till now, I don't know whether ingenious officers have raised this issue or not. In my opinion, it should not apply for this reason. Then, 94B has been inserted, which is, again, a very interesting provision. Again said to be in accordance with international practice. I am not an international man, but if it is in accordance with international practice, obviously international people have not protested as they should have protested. It says that if you enter into a transaction with an associated enterprise and you agree to pay interest to that associated enterprise, then even though the rate of interest passes the test of transfer pricing, it will not be allowed if it exceeds, ultimately the interest payment exceeds 30% of the earnings of that company before taking into account interest, taxes, depreciation and amortization, referred alphabetically as EBITDA. Now, if that is so, even though I pay 10% interest, which is not excessive, but if my profits are less than 30%, reduction will not be allowed. How can that be? Surely allowance of interest cannot depend on whether it exceeds the profit which you ultimately make. The reason given is that people pay excessive interest because the recipient is in a country where interest is taxed at a lower rate. Now, if that person has taken advantage of this, why should I suffer who am paying the interest? And why should that be disallowed? To me, again, this seems patently wrong. In this connection also, you may have regard to the provisions of the Double Taxation Avoidance Agreement, which says that in Article 24, Clause 4, that if there is a payment of interest, then you will not treat it more adversely than you would in a local enterprise. So if I borrow money from an Indian enterprise and my profit at the end of the day is not 30%, no consequence. By virtue of Article 24, you cannot have such a provision in the Act, because whatever is more beneficial will prevail. Again, I don't know whether negotiations of DTAs are carried out by the Ministry of Law, and therefore the Ministry of Finance is unaware about it. If so, not only must the Minister of Finance be the Minister of Company Law, but of law generally, so that they know exactly what has been done and you don't act contrary to an agreement. Now, I am old-fashioned, which you must realize, and I think it is more important to comply with an agreement rather than the law. If I enter into an agreement, I must stand by it. Not that you must do something illegal, but you must stand by the agreement. Now, Double Taxation Avoidance Agreement is an agreement. Having entered into that agreement, how can you frame a law which goes contrary to that? It's not a matter of morality, it is a question of your common perception of how you must function. Now, you get MAT credit. It is now provided in 115JA that the carry forward period will be 15 years and not 10 years. Again, if you are under the presumptive tax regime and carrying on a profession other than the profession of law, medicine, etc., advance tax can be paid by you in one installment by 15th March. But if you are in the presumptive tax regime and you are a professional, that advantage will not be available, unless it is a profession other than accounting, etc., etc. Then I come to certain other provisions. Section 43B, which says that certain payments will be deducted on payment basis, not when the liability arises, but when actual payment is made. Interest payable to cooperative banks is now included in it. Perhaps to see to it that cooperative banks get that interest in time, because you can't get a deduction for the interest merely on an accrual basis. Then there is a limit provided for maintenance of accounts and for getting your accounts audited. These limits have now been raised so that even if the income is up to 2,50,000, one doesn't have to maintain books of account. Even if the turnover is 25 crores, earlier it was 10 crores, you don't have to maintain books of account. To encourage foreign persons to lend money to Indian enterprises, it is now provided that TDS will have to be made on making payment of interest to the foreign lender at only 5% and not the earlier rate. Interesting amendment in Section 58. Section 58 deals with income from other sources. And the question arises that in respect of business income, if you don't deduct tax at source, you don't get the deduction. It is now provided that this will also apply to income from other sources. So if you don't deduct tax from a payment which is chargeable as income from other sources, you will not get the deduction. If it is a payment to a non-resident, if it is to a resident and you don't deduct tax, then 30% of the tax, 30% of the tax which is there will be disallowed. Provision is made now that person who earn taxable income have to file their returns. I don't think one need, I missed your time on that. 115 JB has been amended so as to make it compliant with provisions in the Companies Act, provisions in the Indian Accounting Standards, provisions in the company's Indian Accounting Standard rules, so that 115 JB, the accounts which you have to draw up, are in conformity with the various requirements I have referred to. Conversion of preference shares to equity shares. It is provided that that will not be regarded as a transfer, and you will not have to pay tax on the basis of the difference between the cost of the preference share and the value of the equity share. In determining the value of the cost of the equity share, you will take into account appropriate cost of the preference share. Appropriate in the sense that if two preference shares are converted into an equity share, you will take into account the cost of two shares. Also, the period of holding of the preference share will be regarded as a period of holding of the equity share, so that you don't have to hold the equity share for 1 year thereafter. It will be a lesser period because you will add the period for which you held the preference shares. Then 115 BBG, interesting provision, and the question is where there is a carbon credit, and carbon credit you get if you have arranged your affairs so that there is not emission which is not good for the environment. An amount received for a carbon credit has been held by the Andhra Pradesh High Court and the Karnataka High Court is a capital receipt, not chargeable to tax. Some tribunals have taken a different view. Now what they provide is that what you receive for a carbon credit by selling, because you can sell this carbon credit to another concern which has to comply with emission requirements but has not complied with it. What you get for sale of the carbon credit will be assessed to tax at 10%. Now question will arise, if the Karnataka and the Andhra Pradesh High Courts are right in saying it is not income, can you levy tax at 10% on that? Because then it will mean a tax not on capital gain, because you can levy tax on capital gain. Can you levy tax under the Income Tax Act on capital receipts, assuming it is a capital receipt? So perhaps an issue may arise, should they amend 224 to include amount received for sale of a carbon credit as a part of the income of the SSC. Just as you are aware, there are government grants which were held to be capital receipts, but they were now regarded as being income, and you amended 224 to include these government grants as a part of income. That has not been done with regard to this position. Now, interesting question. It is now said that there must be an intimation made when a return is filed for assessment year 2018-19 onwards. Up till then, it was not necessary compulsorily to make an intimation. Now, a question which arises, and perhaps some of you have experienced it, you file a return claiming a refund. He doesn't make an intimation, doesn't make an assessment. What happens? You can't file an appeal because an appeal is against an order. Then what? You have to go to the High Court to say, please dispose of my refund application. And if it means that to get an assessment made, you have to go to the High Court, in my view, it shows a sorry state of affairs. Because if I make a claim for refund, it has to be processed. But this position is there. Now that intimations are made compulsory, this question may not become relevant. Then, we always say this is a government which works. Yeah. But the authority for advance rulings, which was set up to hasten disposal of matters and not get locked up in interminable litigation, does not have a presiding officer for the last 6 months. Now, it is not as if you don't know when the vacancy will arise. He has to retire at a certain age. You know that in advance. Why can you not appoint a person? And please note, this is not a case of conflict between the collegium of judges and the government as to who is to be appointed a High Court judge. This is simply a case of appointing the chairman of the authority for advance rulings. But for 6 months, you don't do it. Of course, if that is an example of government working, it really shows that they have a restful period. Then I would invite your attention to certain provisions for time limits. I've already pointed out time limit for assessment orders has been reduced. Time limit for making 148 assessments have been increased. And time limit for assessment in search cases have also been reduced. Now the position is that if compensation is received for land acquisition, then under the Land Acquisition and Rehabilitation Resettlement Act, that compensation is not assessable to tax. A general provision is there that you have to deduct from the compensation amount tax at source. Now this will not apply because of the provision there in the Act. There are one or two other matters I would like to refer to. One is about income from house property. If you have a loss in house property, then you can set it off against income from other heads. But now it is stated that you cannot set off a loss of more than 2 lakhs of rupees from house property. I don't know why. If I have suffered a loss from house property, why should I not be able to set it off? If you can assess what I earn from income from house property, why should I not get the set off? Of course, small mercy, you can carry it forward. But why not in this year itself? Because supposing next year I don't have a profit, or in the year after, I won't be able to set it off. So therefore, to me, it really makes, again, this is said to be best international practice. Now, I am not an international person, but what is best international practice about set off of income from house property? You just give something, a terminology, which you think people will say, ha ha, very good. But where is the question of any international practice in this? It goes against the basic rule of taxation that you must pay tax on your net income after setting off losses, and there are provisions in which what circumstances you can set off such losses. Now, one more provision which I would like to comment upon, and that is section 132. 132 gives a power of search, and it is provided in the Act that such a power of search can be exercised only if there is information in the possession of the person issuing the authorization which gives him reason to believe certain things. So he must have reason to believe. Now what are the reasons? One, which is acceptable, that this SSE was called upon to produce certain documents or certain items which he did not produce. So I will have a search carried out to see if I can get those documents. Well enough. But then the second condition is, if the commissioner feels, or the principal commissioner feels, today now there are principal commissioners, principal directors, etc., etc. When I joined, there was commissioner, AAC, and officer. Now you have greater employment potentiality by increasing 7 or 8 types of people you can have. Anyway, so now the principal commissioner, second condition is, if he believes that, he is not likely to produce that document. Now, how do you rationally come to the conclusion that he will not produce that document? Purely subjective. Yes, I feel he will not do it. But there must be some basis. I can understand. In the past, he has not produced, he has not complied with directions. So he was not likely to. I can understand. But otherwise, easiest thing to say, I don't think he will produce this document, so I order a search. Now, up till now, one had the ability, the opportunity to challenge a search by moving the High Court and asking the officer to produce the reasons for his belief that he will not produce this document. How do you come to that conclusion? And judgments have emphasized that the power of search is extremely wide, but it has to be within certain confines. And the fact that you have to record your satisfaction, which can be adjudicated upon, is a proper remedy. Now, you can always say, I will not reveal what was the reason. If you can point out, for example, it will affect India's international relations. The government of another country gives you some information. I will not reveal it. Yes. But you can't say, I will not just reveal it. And now they have inserted an explanation in section 132, which says that for the removal of doubts, it is hereby declared that the reason to believe, as recorded by the income tax authority, shall not be disclosed to any person or any authority or the tribunal. Now, what does this mean? Any person would mean SSE, authority would mean commissioner, tribunal is mentioned. Does it mean that if I go to the High Court, you will have to reveal it? And does it mean that I have always to go to the High Court, I have no remedy at lower down? Must it not be that you try to curtail litigation and not force a person to go to the High Court? Now, judgments also lay down that yes, he must record his satisfaction, but he can show why I will not reveal it. Judge will decide, yes, this should not be revealed. But consider today, you have an enmity with Mr. B. And Mr. B goes to your officer and says, look, this fellow has got concealed income which he has kept here, there and everywhere. And he says, I have reason to believe, I am issuing search. But is that correct? Must there not be some set-aside? They say that an Englishman's home is his castle. And you cannot enter it without permission. In India, we don't have castles, but surely an Indian's home is equally entitled to privacy. Now, how do they organize a search? You must have experienced. You can't start a search after 6 p.m. So what will he do? He will come to your premises at 5:30 and then carry on the search till 2 a.m. next morning and subject you to an investigation and cross-examination at 2 a.m. After 8 hours of search, you are obviously not in the best frame of mind to respond. Is this a good practice? Must you encourage it? Or must you say that no, this cannot be? Isn't it that if 6 p.m. is the time and you enter at 5:30 or 5:45, that itself shows malafides? So therefore, this provision for the removal of doubts. Now there is something even more. There is a certain power for ordering a search if you have a suspicion, and it is provided for the removal of doubts that the reason to suspect as recorded will not also be revealed. So not only must you have a reason to believe, you can have a reason to suspect, and that also is not to be revealed. Now, I think this flies in the teeth of a person's liberty. And I wonder whether Mr. Trump is the president of this country. Because I can understand riding over, roughshod over a person's sense of liberty and doing what you think is right. But America is supposed to be a democracy. India is still a democracy. And that cannot be allowed to function. So this is a very serious matter, and I think it is something which should agitate the minds of everybody. There are several judgments. I don't want to refer to them. We are getting on to the time of closure, where they have laid down what are the guidelines which must be followed in such cases. Somebody says, look, the person who will authorize a search is a principal commissioner. Will he do something off his bat? I leave it to you to judge. Because I have seen cases where, as you are aware, before you issue a notice under 148, you have to take the sanction in certain circumstances of the commissioner. I have seen cases where the reason is recorded at 11 a.m., the file is sent to the commissioner, and at 2 p.m. he gives his sanction. Now, is there time sufficient for him to consider if this is a fit case for reopening? And this happens sometimes when the officer is located at one place and the commissioner is 5 miles away. So please also factor in the time of sending the papers to him and his looking into it, sanctioning it, and it coming back on the same day. Therefore, the fact that it is a higher official who is to do it, I think is no protection. Because all persons are subject to human failings. One more issue. If 132 reason is not to be disclosed, what do you say to the reason for reopening an assessment? Because 148 says, and the high courts have laid down, if you get a 148 notice, you can ask for the reasons, and he has to supply the reasons before making the assessment. Will tomorrow you say, no, that reason also need not be disclosed? What is the difference between disclosing a reason for ordering a search and for reopening an assessment? In fact, a search is something even more, because you are entering my house without my permission. So therefore, now one more thing interesting. This has been inserted retrospectively. So all past cases also where they'd be pending in appeal, you will say, no, I don't have to disclose anything. Now this government said, we will not have retrospective legislation. Is it normal to carry out what you say you will do? Or it is the done thing to depart from it, which is what you have done? Does it affect the credibility of the government in power? Now the finance minister, in his speech, gave us certain figures, which he said showed that people were not complying with their tax obligations. For example, he said that there were 14 lakh companies registered. Only 6 lakh filed their returns, which, subject to audit, comes to 44%. Also, he said that profit of more than 1 crore is disclosed only by 6% of, only by 36,500 people. And therefore, there is not proper disclosure, or the SSEs do not comply with their obligations. But do you give an incentive to comply with obligations by saying that I will order a search and I will not be responsible for telling you why? Or does it mean I'm not treated fairly? If I'm not treated fairly, why should I treat the revenue fairly? I'm not suggesting it, I'm not saying do it, I'm only telling you that this is the reason. You must have experienced, all of you, that when you receive your fees, tax is deducted at source. Again, I presume all of you must have experienced that X has been deducted at source, but he gives you credit for X minus Y, because there is some mysterious form, AS or SA or whatever it is called, and it says this doesn't tally. But it will not tally because I am on a cash basis. The other person is on a mercantile basis. So he will deduct tax and pay it in an earlier year. Or he may deduct tax and not pay it over. Now the person who deducts tax is not my agent. I don't tell him deduct tax. He is the agent of the government. If that agent doesn't do something which he should, am I liable? So if I have this, that I don't get a fair treatment, then why should I take my obligation seriously? If I feel I won't be treated fairly, why should I treat the government fairly? I'm not saying that is a reason not to file your return properly, but I'm telling you what a human being thinks. And finance ministers, people in the ministry, principal commissioners are human beings. At least we hope so. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Please be seated for 2 more minutes. Sir, it is not the international practice, but it is the BCS practice to call Mr. Dastoor year after year. And thank you for an excellent exposition, sir. May I request Manish to do the honors?
Thank you, Chetan. Before I propose a word of thanks to Mr. Dastoor, there are a couple of society announcements regarding the forthcoming program. On 9th of February, BCA has arranged a lecture meeting free of cost on indirect tax proposals of the Finance Act 2017. And since not a lot of amendments are there, so this will be coupled with important aspects in GST and its implementation issues. And this will be addressed by Senior Counsel Vikram Nankani at the BCA venue. On 13th of February, there is a program or lecture meeting on international tax provisions of Finance Act 2017 by CA T.P. Oswal. And this is a joint program at the IMC by Bombay Chartered Accountants Society, the Chamber of Tax Consultants, and the IFA. Now, secondly, we would like to acknowledge the family members of Mr. Dastoor here. And we would like to thank Mr. Dastoor and the family members to grace the occasions and support a lot of initiatives of the society, especially the students' programs. Now, proposing a vote of thanks to a speaker like Mr. Dastur is like adding glitter to gold, but I'll make an attempt. The lecture meeting on the budget lecture meeting organized by the Bombay Chartered Accountant Society is like an annual pilgrimage, and I remember my days when I was beginning my career and I used to sit right there till today. And sir, I also see a lot of professionals, three generation of professionals from the same family over here. So this talks about the respect, the love, and the respect and love that we have for you. Friends, we all are accounting professionals, and by a simple math of 29 lecture meetings on budget out of 52 shows that this lecture meeting, budget lecture meeting, has become a subsidiary of Mr. Dastur, and he has total controlling interest on this program. Seniors and friends, with these words, please join me in proposing a very hearty and well-deserved word of thanks to Mr. Dastur. Thank you, sir.
Symbolic.